Good evening. Thank you all so much for coming on this, our first official winter night in Cleveland. My name is Megan Lykins-Rich. I'm deputy director here at moCa Cleveland. And I want to welcome you all to tonight's event, our panel discussion called Bare Threads. And I want to acknowledge all of you who are here for the first time. We welcome you and thank you for coming and experiencing this program. And for all of you who are return visitors, we deeply appreciate your ongoing and enduring patronage, and we appreciate you coming back. Tonight's event extends from our current exhibition, Wall to Wall Carpets by Artists, on view in the Cole Atrium, the Cahoon Lounge, the Mueller Family Gallery, and the Cohen Family Gallery. I would like to start by acknowledging and thanking our generous sponsors, and I'll name them all and then we can applaud at the end. For Wall to Wall exhibition and its related programs, we thank sponsors Westlake Reed Laskowski, Mannington Commercial, and Bello Design, along with the Intercontinental Hotel Cleveland for their community support. All 2006 and 2017 exhibitions are funded by leadership gifts from an anonymous donor, Yuval Brisker, Joanne Cohen and Morris Wheeler, Margaret Cohen and Kevin Rahili, Becky Dunn, Harriet Goldberg, Agnes Gund, Michelle Jeschelnig-Sean and Richard Jeschelnig, Don and Stuart Cole, Toby Devon Lewis, and Scott Mueller. All MoCa exhibitions are supported in part by the residents of Cuyahoga County through a public grant from Cuyahoga Arts and Culture, the Cleveland Foundation, the Gund Foundation, and the continuing support of the museum's board of directors, patrons, and members. Please join me in thanking all of our sponsors. And now on to tonight's discussion. A key premise to wall is the notion that while the carpet is an ancient and broadly familiar medium, contemporary artist-designed carpets represent a relatively new practice and one that is significant to our ever-shifting cultural landscape. From a contemporary art standpoint, wall-to-wall represents a kind of dissolving of boundaries between art, design, and craft that seems to be increasing as artists sample and move between disciplines more fluidly. Looking outside of the specific vantage point of contemporary art, however, the exhibition takes up additional issues, ranging from the collaborative requirements of cultural production today to its complex economic and geopolitical relationships. Tonight's panelists bring a wealth of direct experience and important perspectives to this arena. They are the producers, the intrepid individuals who drive these complex art and design projects. I'm going to briefly introduce them as they will be talking a little bit about their personal and professional histories as we get the conversation going. To my right is Christopher Farr, founder and director of London and LA-based company that carries his name, a design studio that has been spearheading innovation in contemporary carpet and textile design for over 25 years. Beside Christopher is Joakim Andreasson, the founder and director of Culture Edit, an LA-based company that creates markets and manages creative collaborations and projects with an independent stance across art, design, and fashion. And the beautiful woman on the end is Petra Singh, the co-founder and director of Equator Production, a New York-based company dedicated to commissioning carpet designs from contemporary international artists and orchestrating the execution and production of these designs in limited editions by traditional Nepalese weavers. All three of these producers have carpets represented in Wall to Wall, which you can see on the scrolling PowerPoint above us. Please join me in welcoming our panelists. So to kick it off, I've had the pleasure of talking with each of these wonderful people privately about their backgrounds, and origin stories are very helpful in setting the stage for the projects that they currently work on. So I would invite each of them to tell us a little bit about their histories and how their personal and professional histories led them to the world of carpet production. So Chris, we'll start with you.
Right, thank you. Can you hear that? Yeah, good. I started off as an artist in London. I went to art school for 6 years. And in my vacation time, I worked in a rug gallery in Notting Hill Gate in London and became very sort of entranced by this medium. Anonymous, no names, nothing like that. And when I was at the State School doing a postgraduate course, I got the chance to do go to South America, to Peru, for 3 months on a traveling scholarship, and I became acquainted with pre-Columbian art and textiles in particular. And so that really touched me in a way that sort of, you know, it's still resonating right now. And that led me to going to Turkey in the 1984 to the villages in Western Turkey with two carpet experts. One was a famous rug dealer called David Black, and one was the world authority on Oriental carpets, Dr. John Thompson. And there's little old me. And so we go to these villages and we see where they are resurrecting traditional designs and making them in the traditional way, which they've been doing for hundreds of years. And I'm thinking, these are great, this is very exciting, and it's an incredibly romantic and powerful experience. But with my art background, I was thinking, could I work with these weavers and do different designs? And so that led to a rift with my esteemed partners, who thought I was corrupting the whole tradition, which in a sense I was, but I felt that because I'd bought and sold these nomadic tribal 19th century rugs before that, you know, in auctions and stuff, I had some understanding of who I was dealing with. And so that led to me starting my own company in 1988. And my sort of, I'm a kind of a freak in the sense that I have this sort of weird tribal rug thing going on. I have this knowledge of fine art and design. My father was a big design historian. So I had this sort of weird cocktail of background to do this. And so I just ventured off on my own and got going. I think the big breakthrough for me was a project I was asked to do at the Royal College of Art in 91. It was in the teeth of a recession. Everyone was depressed. I worked with the students. We made the best rugs, the best designs we made into rugs, and it just took off from there. We had massive publicity. People were very excited, and things basically started from there. That's me.
Great, thank you. Joakim, what about you?
My foray into the art rug world is much more accidental than that. My background, I've had a number of positions across fashion, art, and designs. But in 2013, I started my own firm where I purposely engaged collaboration between artists and commercial brands and vice versa. I had just moved to LA. This was 2013, and I was furniture shopping, and I came across the catalog of a rug company named Henzel Studio. Henzel Studio is spearheaded by the founder, Kalle Henzel, and I realized that his methodology in making the rugs was different than what I knew at the time. He was an artist in his own right. He made artwork, and then based on these artworks, he then turned them into rugs, and this was his creative outlet. Having worked with a number of high-profile people in New York for a number of years, I had access to big-name artists, and I thought, well, there's a bigger picture here. Why not engage this company in particular with bigger names? I approached the company the day after. His wife happened to be in town in LA at the time. We had dinner, and Henzel Studio Collaborations was initiated. And we worked for a good 2 years to really create a solid group of 12 artists, and we launched these simultaneously. And it's been a wonderful experience. But rugs are not, when it comes to production of rugs, that's not what I do. What I do is select the artists, I curate this, the names and the artwork, and then make sure that it's sort of handled properly within the marketplace.
Thank you. Petra, how about you?
Yes. I met my now late husband in 1985, and he was, from a very young age, a very vivid art collector, started off with prints and editions. And then he moved from Canada to Brussels, which was very close to Cologne. And then he turned his interest to a true work of art, original works of art. He started meeting with artists collected back then, the Mühlheimer Freiheit. And out of this friendship with the artists and his desire, he was from India, he was born in India. He always wanted, well, now it's kind of a term, giving back. He always felt, how can he kind of connect the Western contemporary art with a craft in India? And well, when we met each other and we were talking what could be done, and we had would love to go to carpet stores, look at beautiful carpets, but we realized that this was not exactly what we wanted. They were beautiful, classic, but we thought, well, why not ask those artists that we were collecting if they would be interested in designing carpets that could be produced in India, which was in the mid-80s. There were not many people thinking of it, because actually a lot of the collectors felt it was not exactly hip to have a rug on the floor. The bare wooden floor was all the rage. So there we are, and we started off trying to locate some workshops. We went to India, and we've given money to Indian workshops, and they burned through it. We didn't get a rug. A year later, we still haven't located one. And luckily enough, we met with the Charitable Trust of the Dalai Lama, which was back then, which he still does, is a sister of the Dalai Lama. It's a children village. And those were children who had escaped the peril of Tibet. They escaped, and in order for them to provide a livelihood, they were training them in their craft. So we hooked up with them, which was kind of an adventure, because they could really not understand why on earth would we want to do anything, you know, like this contemporary designs, maybe presenting them, why we would like them to be made instead of buying their wonderful ancient designs. But it was a wonderful experience with these children and young people, but they were not exploited. They were actually just taught a craft. So it was the first collaboration, which started in the mid-80s. And as I said, they were all friends, artists that we were collecting. So we were not going out trying to engage with people we didn't know. We were just sitting on the table. We're basically all our drinking buddies, and we present them with a great idea. And said, yeah, why not? And the first one we started off with was Georg Dokupil. He was back then a very, very well-known artist. His first carpets we produced were unique pieces, only one of them. And then, you know, we moved Rosemarie Trockel, Felix Gonzalez Torres. And we did this for quite a while. But after about, what say, about 10 years, the Charitable Trust of the Dalai Lama did not want to do this anymore, because it became less and less this craft part of, became more schools, universities. So we were starting to look at other facilities, and that's when we started moving to Nepal, because we liked the Tibetan carpets. And so it all started in the mid-80s. We reached out to our friends who designed the first carpets, and that was the beginning, and it's still a little bit the same. For me, it has all, for us, he passed away in the meantime, it's always been not really approaching unknown people, because it's all very difficult. Most of the people we started off with were friends, we produced them, and I continue to do so.
Thank you. So let's dive into specifically the experience of working with contemporary artists, which as a curator, I can say, is both exciting and often very complicated. And that's when I'm working with artists who are producing objects that come out of their normal practice for a museum setting, which is pretty traditional. But in the realm of working with contemporary artists to produce carpets, many of whom aren't actual weavers or have never worked in this medium, it can, I imagine, be far more complex. So broadly speaking, can you tell us what some of the advantages are of working with contemporary artists on these projects? And on the flip side, with or without naming names, what are some of the challenges or obstacles that you face in these experiences? Whoever wants to jump in.
I mean, for me, it's been a pleasurable experience across the board to work with contemporary artists. I think they're very much attracted to the craft, and getting the offer to do a rug for them just is a very meaningful medium, because the rugs in themselves have such inherent history that it's something that really resonates with them. So have had very few no's, and it's been no's has been due to political reasons that has to do with the art worlds or financial structures, and not really to do with their creative want or strive to actually embrace this media. But the difficulties is really about physicality. Where are you? Can we meet up? Can you have a look at this? What do you think about this nuance of color? Is this good enough for you? All these facets. I've even had, due to timelines and time constraints, even had scenarios where the artist only sees their rug maybe even 5 months after the rug is released. Mm-hmm. So it's more about finding ways within the world we live in and also engaging artists that are not within your proximity to actually collaborate in a modern way.
Yeah, I think that's interesting. I would say there's a scale. It's to do with surrender and control. And some artists are good at surrendering, like none of them, and some are very controlling. And I think really you measure your experience working with an artist on that scale. And my war stories, and I know when you said names, you wanted me to name names, like we're not mentioning any names means that you want names, so maybe I'll drop one at the end, but there are some who really cannot fucking well let go, and that's so hard to deal with. You really
Why is
struggle.
It important that they are able to let go in this particular arena?
Sorry?
Why is it important that they can't have control? Like, tell us more about why the production
I think studio practice is so solitary. I mean, it's less so now with all the assistants, but really, fundamentally, it is down to that. It's this incredible one-on-one relationship with your work, and suddenly to sort of send it overseas to India, to Turkey, to Afghanistan, and to have your work interpreted. It's a bit like, you know, a translation. It's a similar sort of thing. If you've written a poem and you get translated into Swahili, you're going to have something to say about it because it may not, you know, resonate with what you were trying to express. And so color, design, technique, and why can't they do that? Why can't they weave that? I mean, okay, a good example is that we did a rug with Louise Bourgeois just before she died, and she just sort of passed it. And she had this thing, it's called, has the day invaded the night, or has the night invaded the day? And this is a woman who didn't sleep much. She did a lot of her work sitting up in bed at 3 or 4 in the morning. So this had a very powerful thing, and her assistant, Jerry Convoy, said, because I was looking at her work and thinking, well, that would make a great rug, and that would make a great rug. Well, he told me to shut the F up and said, this is what we're going to do, because this really represents something very powerful about her. And so, and the weave that she liked was the Moroccan Berber weave, which are very, very trendy right now. You can even get versions of it in Crate and Barrel. But it's very wild weaving. It's from the mountain, Atlas Mountains in Morocco. And to get a weaver, a traditional weaver to weave English, those words in their wild, woolly, shaggy weave was an absolute nightmare. And it took us 3 years to produce this rug. And we got the sample to her just before she died, and she said, yes, that's it. But she wanted that friction. That I was convinced that that's what it was about. That she, nothing, you know, you need heat to make something. And she thought the contrast of her words in English by relatively illiterate women weavers from the mountains of Morocco would be give the power to the rug, to the object that she was trying to make.
Yes, my experience was, I mean, as I said from the beginning, we were mainly friends. We started off with, so there was not so much of a real diva attitude. The bigger problem was, this was more of the gallerist. The moment there was a gallerist involved, it became always very murky, very muddy, and they would always try to kind of set the artists against you. Like, they would just put, oh, you know, are you sure they're not cheating you? You know, it was always a bit about the money aspect, where they were trying to, you know, make you look bad. And other than that, I think my experience with the artists was always fun. For me, it has to be fun. If it's not fun, I drop it. Very simple. Even with the artists, as much as I like it, if I see after a few months there is no communication, or it's only over demanding, or they're not trying to understand, too, what is it a weaver can do? Which has changed a lot. In the 80s, you started off with, for example, a carpet, 80 knots per square inch. We had 30 colors. That was it. There was nothing, you know, there was not big a variation of it. They did what they could do. And the artists would, you know, had to understand whatever the design they gave us, it had to be something that could be translated into this medium like that. And it was not a big problem. It became much more difficult than in the 90s when people would give me photographs. And I said, I'm very sorry, I cannot by then was 100 knots per square inch. I can't do this. This was the biggest problem I had sometimes to get across to the artist. Listen, just think of it. You have 80 knots per square inch, and with that, your design has to be able to translate into a rug. Mm-hmm. But other than that, my experience with the artists of some standing was actually always very straightforward. Most of them were kind of professional, and they were looking forward for a collaboration. The problem was very often with the artists, which were not very famous or well-known. I don't know what it was. I mean, there are a couple of people that are trying to work in Wiz now, and they make it so difficult, and I just think, I don't want to say to them and say, well, you know what? If I call up Rosemarie Trockel and I make a carpet with her, she responds, she's nice, why is it that you have to shoot me those nasty emails? You know what I mean? So, again, that has been my experience, but as I said, for me it's an adventure which I enjoy. I enjoy the artist, and if not, I don't do it.
Thank you. So, Joakim, when you began this relationship with Kyle Henzel and Henzel Studio, called Henzel Studio Collaborations, how did you go about identifying the artist? You said you had relationships, and you told me over the phone when we talked last week that the first artist that you confirmed was Richard Prince, which is not a slack artist. Like, that's a good name to start with. So talk about that first, getting Richard Prince to sign on, and how that initiation of that project went along, and kind of what you learned early on in working with artists in relation to Cal Henzel and his studio that helped kind of perfect the model? Because I'm sure it wasn't super smooth out the gate.
No, I mean, it was literally, okay, let's do this. That's how it started. You know, like, we engaged with the company. They were like, okay, let's start collaborations. Now what, you know? So the reason that I sort of have, not that I know people, it's just more about, like, I know how to get to people, because I worked with a big fashion designer for 8 years. His name is Helmut Lang, and I still do, but it's just certain politics and certain ways of approaching getting projects to the table of certain people, and I had that at my hand, which is great. But so when it came to selecting, I mean, I think there's a number of layers. I think the first layer is your subjective layer, which is completely selfish. It's about who do you like? Whose artwork do you admire? Who do you want to see actually translate their work into the media at hand, which is rugs? So it's purely selfish, stage one. And then stage two is about finding people who you think would be willing to work outside of their comfort zone. So purposely chose artists that were not purists, 100%. Because I think there's a little bit too much of carefulness. I think that doing a rug or doing anything outside your comfort zone or the gallery structure requires a sense of, I do what I want, I'm autonomous, I'm independent. And a lot of artists are not that way in the current system today. Richard Prince, I got to because I've been working with Jürgen Teller, who's a famous photographer, and his wife is Richard Prince gallerist. So I managed to get a proposal to Richard, and the day after he said yes, and the day after that, I had the design in my computer. So that was a very
so that's the perfect artist to work with.
That was the perfect artist. He obviously already thought about textiles, kind of. Not sure if he had thought about a rug, but his design is very textile-based in the sense that, I don't know if you've seen it scrolling, but it's basically a composition of backdrops of baseball t-shirts or baseball jerseys. So it's this composition of numbers, and it's a free form. So he already had the shape in mind. Basically, when I approach artists, I had a whole framework figured out. So you had to have all your parameters set, so it's a yes or a no, and not a maybe, or what if, or what it could be. Could it be this? I purposely made it, thought about all the aspects so it was easy to digest this, because it's an extremely complex procedure to do a rug, so you have to make it digestible, because artists are not rug makers, they're artists. So that said, once Richard was on board, it was, I mean, I had already started approaching people, but they were sort of thinking, oh, well, who else is, because it's all about who you're in the company of a lot of times, especially when you do a grouping, because my intent was to launch 12 at the same time, not one at a time, which is gutsy as well, but yes.
That's it.
Oh, there we go. That's the prince rug. Once we had prints, it was just easier to confirm other people because of the hierarchy of the picking order of the art world. And we had 12 names, and they include also Merle Minter, which is one of the rugs upstairs that has these water drop effect. Also includes Helmut Lang, Jürgen Teller, Anselm Reile, Jack Pearson, Mickalene Thomas. I mean, a fabulous group, if I may say so, of artists. And we launched them simultaneously, and that's how the project was conceived, and now it's an ongoing program that we constantly invite artists on an ongoing basis.
Great. So Petra, you began, and you sort of have had two iterations of Equator Production, the early years in the 80s and early 90s, and then a very recent sort of resurgence and renewal of the production with a new set of artists. So I'm curious about how, if at all, the experience that you've had working with contemporary artists has changed. And in particular, like, if you see that contemporary artists that you're working with now are more poised to depart into carpet making because perhaps the contemporary art world is more open to this sort of fluid boundary exchange than it was in the sort of mid-80s, outside of Rosemarie Trockel, who was already sort of working in weaving as part of her practice. But do you see that the artists now who you are working with have a greater awareness or potential, maybe technology helping through that to open them up to this potential, or are the sort of challenges the same that you faced early on?
Well, I think the challenges are similar. When I, after my husband's passing, decided to kind of reinvent Equator Production, since I liked my little flying rug business so much and I, you know, never wanted to let it go. I went first again, begging order, I went to my friend Rosemarie Trockel, said, Rosie, you know, you've made 5-6 carpets with me before. Would you be interested? Would you support me in reviving Equator Production? And of course, that would be vital to it. If I have you on board, it'd probably be much easier for me to approach other artists that I like or admire, or, you know, I would like to be part of my project. So, and so I went to Rosemarie Trockel, and once, you know, absolutely, but she said she wanted to do something different because she's done, like, you see in the show upstairs, there's a plus-minus carpet, and I had one made in Western Germany, a Wuhlmark. Actually, carpets in the 80s made at the same time when she had her textiles, her machine-made weaving, so, you know, well, you kind of call them paintings, her wool work, were done at the same time. So now she wanted to do something different. And I was totally open to it, and it took me 2.5 years. It's now, as we speak, finished being shipped to Berlin to her for approval. It just took 9 months to get the perfect yellow. It's a long process, like you said yourself. And I actually like that. And I especially if it's not a diva attitude, it's because somebody really gives it a thought. It's not just something they want to throw out there. They don't just take an artwork they have and turn it into a carpet. That was another thing very often. I wanted to make sure that artists didn't just give me, oh, take that painting, make it into a rug. I would say, listen, this is like you would make a print or, you know, or any other edition you have to really from scratch. It has to be, you know, if you make it, it should be work from all four sides and stuff like that, you know. So it was Rosemarie Trockel, as I said, it was a 2.5 year process. We're finished. And once I had Aaron board, I would think, oh, who am I going to approach next? And I met with my friend Cornelia Lau from Golden Ruler. And
who is the curator of the wall-to-wall exhibition.
Exactly, and we're talking about it, and I said, well, you know, I would like to enlist you. Know her for 30 years. I've done with her ex-husband, Joseph Kossuth, a very nice carpet as well in the 80s. Would you be interested in working for me to get a group of artists together, and you get them to work with through you with me in Equator? So this was a little different. I have never enlisted before somebody who would curate something for me. So I went that route because, like you said, it made much more sense. Just one carpet, another carpet. I wanted to have a group to relaunch Equator Production. So that has changed from before. And now that seemed to, you know, like for example, Rosemarie Trockel is proposing now a group of artists, which she kind of puts in a good word for me, and hopefully it's going to work out. This is going to be the next step. And that's where I am. And as I said before, for me it's an adventure. It has to be fun, and I'm looking forward. I'm very excited how it's going to continue. And I think it has changed. I think it has changed because the artists now that have, you know, I mean, of course, if you have an artist standing, it's easier to sell, clearly. But also those artists, because it's, you know, they are approached all the time, whether for T-shirts, plays. I mean, they're constantly, like Rosemarie Trockel, she doesn't entertain this at all, but she was my friend, so she did it for me. But Nomi, I think I understand too, because a lot of those artists are just bombarded constantly with requests. So I think it's, for me, I think it's more difficult now to get the artists of your choice and liking to actually collaborate with you. Yes.
Interesting. So Chris, let's talk about a project that you did outside of your sort of normal, I'm gonna call it studio practice with contemporary artists, which was a hammer exhibition that you did, you sort of initiated in 2015, that was called the Afghan Project, where six female artists were invited to design carpets and then go to Afghanistan and meet with the weavers that were going to execute it, which were also female weavers. And then the Hammer did an exhibition of the finished project. So tell us about how this project came about, how you conceived it, what were the goals, and what were the outcomes of it in relation to the artists that you worked with.
I think you're looking at three masochists here on the stage. I mean, can you imagine we do this for a living? And how much money is there involved in this? Not enough. We got a letter from, in our London studio, from the Department of Defense in about 2012, saying, can you come up with an idea to help the Afghan rug industry? You know, obviously, perhaps they were feeling in my naivety a little bit guilty of the Afghan wars, and they wanted to try to help. And we both thought, my business partner and I, Department of Defense, yeah, we really want to work with you. Not. So it just lay in the in tray for 2 years. And then I was actually talking to some friends of mine in Los Angeles, Kevin and Elisa. I think somebody knows those people. And I was saying, this is still bugging me, this letter. I'm just thinking, and I've kind of wimped out here, and I'm not sort of, maybe there's what happens. One thing I do know, particularly from Alighiero Boetti, is that you can't, if you're a man, work with women weavers in Afghanistan. So duh, why don't I invite women artists? And Kevin and Elisa are on the board of the Hammer Museum. So they said, why don't you meet Annie Philbin? And so we pitched it to her, and she said, yeah, but no one will do it. And so eventually we tossed out a lot of names. And that's interesting, because maybe 10 years ago, you couldn't find 30 or 40 women artist names. They came up with 30 or 40 women artist names, and very quickly indeed. And they toss those names amongst, and we can't work with her because she's this and can't with that. And anyway, those people, about 30 people were invited, and Annie, the director, said, I don't think anyone's going to say yes, and 25 said yes. So that was interesting, and so we got it down to six, and some of them, the artists, had young children, and we got the six artists, and it was kind of interesting. Actually, there's a funny anecdote, because I was in the dentist chair, my dentist in LA, of course he's a celebrity dentist, of course, as you'd expect. He said, what are you doing? I said, I'm going to Afghanistan with six women artists. He said, oh, that's funny, because one of my clients is very pissed off because his daughter-in-law is going with you, I think, and he's not happy at all about that. And it turned out that it was Ed Ruscha's daughter-in-law, and Francesca Gabbiani, who's Eddie, his son's wife, of course. And these women were so ballsy; they just sort of said yes, you know. And I couldn't believe it. And so anyway, we went. We spent 5 days on the ground, And we had the Department of Defense looking after us, and it was kind of crazy. We had two Black Hawk helicopters. We went to Bamiyan, we went to the villages. We had all this, we had 10 security people. I mean, it was a boy's own adventure, in a sense, you know, in a war zone. And there were a lot of political things going on, too, particularly, you know, some of the women artists quite rightly had some serious questions. And in fact, one of the artists, we had Toby Cadore, we had Meg Cranston, Francesca, Gabbiani, Jen Guidi, and Lisa Ann Auerbach, and some very interesting artists who could talk and with interpreters to the weavers because men aren't allowed to, and they worked and they had and they came up with their designs. So and that was, and then we showed the rugs, and it was a very strong. Did you see the show?
Unfortunately, I didn't.
No, you didn't. Right, and it was good. So that was it.
I mean, did any of the artists that you know of after that experience, do you know if any of their practices shifted, or if that was? I mean, it sounds like a deeply impactful experience to do.
Well,
that.
I think if Toba Kadori was here tonight, she would have a few words to say. We've done three attempts at her carpet. I don't know if you know her work. It's incredibly fine and detailed. And I said to our producer in Afghanistan, I said, just say no, you can't do it. And of course, being Turkish, he said yes. That was the psychology. I really fucked that up because I should have said, you know, I said all the wrong things. And he said, yes, of course, Chris, absolutely, I do this. And no, he didn't do this. And we made three attempts, and he failed in each time. And Toba and I can barely. I have so much grief from this artist for not doing this. And we couldn't show it because it wasn't ready to show. And we're still making it now. That's 3 years later. So that's why I said you're looking at three massacres here. Why would we do this?
So we will revisit this idea of the timeline and the weavers momentarily, but I do want Joakim to talk about his most recent project, which is somewhat of a departure from what we've been discussing, which is working directly with living contemporary artists, to a project that you just officially launched in Miami, but moCa was able to launch the first carpet at our benefit in September, which is a collaboration with the Andy Warhol Foundation for Visual Art. So tell us a little bit about how that came up and how that project has differed from working with living artists.
Sure. So when it comes to our approach in making artist-designed rugs, I think what's key is to not have rugs that feature an artwork. It's an art rug in its own self and with its own integrity. So after we launched our first installment of 12 artists, I approached the Warhol Foundation asking if they wanted to collaborate on a collection. Took a while, and there were some other shenanigans going on. But a year later, we started to actually really talking. And I mean, as you can imagine, when dealing with the body of work of Warhol, it's very easy to take an obvious route, which means to just take a well-known piece of art, a well-known piece of work that, you know, Campbell's soup or what have you, and then weave it into a rug, and that's recognizable, anyone knows, and probably commercially will resonate. But to sort of do the collection justice, it was about finding an angle that had artistic integrity in its own right. So that involves a lot of research, finding some kind of angle that has an interesting story that people don't know about. So what I discovered through the research was a tiny book the size of our Hello, My Name Is labels that we're all carrying right now. It's a tiny book. It's an accordion style book, so it folds out. And each page is a abstract die cut of the Marilyn Monroe portrait. So this is a little artist book that Warhol himself did. Nobody really knows the purpose of it. It was never reproduced. There's only one. It's been exhibited twice. And I approached him and said, well, each page of this book really is interesting, and I want to make each page of this book into a rug design. When I first approached him about it, they were like, well, what does this guy want with this book? Like, I don't understand. Like, you know, get him out kind of thing. But then further discussions, further proposals, they got it, and we made it happen. So each of these pages is a rug design, and because of each of these pages was a dissect of the Marilyn Monroe portrait, we also decided to revisit the actual portraits and have Kalle Henzel, the creative director of Henzel Studio, sort of adapt his signature design attributes to the Monroe portraits, which is free form shapes, a little bit of a punk meets erosion style designs to it with random fringes. And we sort of brought to life, I mean, managed to reinterpret also then one of his most famous portraits, which is Monroe. So there was an interesting juxtaposition between something extremely iconic, Monroe, and then something very obscure, which was this adaptation of Monroe. But yes, it just launched last week, and because there's 38 pages in the book, there's 38 designs plus the Monroe designs, so there's about 50 designs in the collection, which sounds like a lot, and it is a lot, but yeah, the project commanded it. The concept commanded all these designs. So.
It's wonderful. Yeah. So I want to move to a broader discussion of sort of the politics around contemporary art, carpet production. In particular, when we give tours of the exhibition, one of the aspects of production that catches our guests, maybe not off guard, but is an area of inquiry for them, is the relationship of the artists who design the works to the weavers who produce the works. So I'd like to start by just asking, and some of you have already touched on this, how do you identify the weavers that you work with? And in terms of their locations, we've sort of touched upon that many of them are located in disadvantaged countries or in areas of political strife or have different religious sort of practices and rituals that challenge the kind of expectations not only of the artist, but of your buyers. So let's talk a little bit about the weavers and the relationship that they play with you and with the artists and even your consumers. Who wants to take it on?
Yes, I think for me, sometimes, you know, like you said, it's not an easy process, and well, you won't become a millionaire with, I mean, I won't become a millionaire with that business. But what's very important for me always was, obviously, already when we did this in the 80s, and we were looking for workshops, we wanted to actually bring something to those weavers who, you know, giving them work would make their life better. So we always put very big big emphasis and took great care to locate workshops that were politically correct, you know? And like I said, the Chalabar of Dalai Lama was a wonderful thing to start off with. I mean, back then, already people, because it was very expensive, in comparison, what it could get produced anywhere else, and people said, oh, why don't you have them produced in China? I said, I mean, China in the 80s, carpets were made, yes, in prison camps. I said, do I really want to have six to eight or 10 weeks weave their misery and sadness and tragedy into the, no, I believe in this energy and I think it will translate. I didn't want that. So I always put a big emphasis on it. And when I was looking, and again, when we moved away from the Shelby Trust and we were trying to locate other workshops, I went different routes. When I revived, in the meantime, I found actually a Nepalese person in New York who put me in touch with their uncle. So that was one thing, but that didn't last long either. So when I revived it, so it was a little more complex. And I've known a lady, and she's done shawls in Nepal, and I trusted her, and I said, can you locate some weavers for me, which she did, and we did samples. Then she wasn't really willing either to send me photos of those workshops. Didn't give me the information that I needed, that I could trust. And then I set forth myself through recommendation, just like, you know, yeah. So she gave me three workshops to work with. And finally, I picked one of them, and I really wanted to make sure it's correct. So, and I think yours too, it's an organization, it's called Good Weave. Become a, I don't know if you do that as well, you become a member of it, and they, India and all kind of places in the world, they make surprise visits, they really investigate, they go in there and they rescue children if there is child labor. You give a certain percentage of whatever you pay for the carpets, you know, as a fee, and they will take that and they'll, you know, build schools, et cetera, et cetera. And it's a very, thorough and very well-respected, maybe the most well-respected certification of its kind. So once I'd found that small workshop through connections of this woman who lived in Nepal, I asked and applied for it, and they went off, and they actually, you know, they took pictures. They go. It's a great organization. I took, you know, I went there also, and I looked at the workshop myself. It's small, it's very simple. And for example, last year when there were the earthquake, the little factory had taken big damage. I'd given them $10,000 up in front for carpets which haven't even been produced, which was, of course, a risk to take. It could have been that they would have never produced them. How are we going to go after that in order to help them to rebuild the workshops? For me, this is very important. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could not picture myself just to make a couple of bucks extra. Well, to exploit someone. I'm sure all of you guys are the same here. It's about the collaboration between the artists. It's about bringing something, and really they need this work. I mean, in Nepal, that's the biggest industry they have, and as more artists, international artists, are going to have carpets produced in Nepal, and not pressing the price, as better it is. And yeah, for me, to locate those workshops, well, you know, everybody has their own ways. I mean, some people may go on the internet or they just contact I don't know what. But for me, it was through connections that I finally decided on my own which ones, which was not the recommended ones because they were much bigger, they were cheaper, but I didn't trust them. And then as a verification process for myself, I became a member of Good Weave. So.
Chris or Joakim, the weavers?
Yeah, it's... It's an interesting question. We started in Turkey in 87, 86 maybe. And now we can't really, we can't work there anymore. We work a little bit. But what's happened is Turkey, of course, has grown economically. And the, you know, they have iPhones in the villages, and they want, the children don't want to sit in front of a loom. And that's a reality that William Morris discovered in 1890 in London, in Merton Abbey, that the carpets he was making were too expensive and the wages were going up and he couldn't do it. And we're in the same situation, but we work in India, Nepal, Afghanistan. We work with an organization called Care and Fair, which is similar to Good Weave, and in Afghanistan it's called Arzu Studio Hope, which is where the money went for the Afghan project, and all the artists gave almost all the money that they earned into that, as we did. So we in Afghanistan, we actually went to the villages. They do, it's actually set up by a very guilty banker from Goldman Sachs, a woman who made far too much money and felt bad about it. So she, good for her, she went out there and set up Arzu Studio Hope, and we went to see what they did. And women now, they have proper health care, prenatal, postnatal, their children have schools. And we went, and it was quite a long trek in four-wheel drives to get into quite dangerous country outside Bamiyan. Bamiyan is where the Buddhas were destroyed by the Taliban, and that's where we flew in the helicopters. And then we drove from there to see where the weavers were working. And so it was very strong moment for the women artists to see exactly who was making their rug and what their life was like and how their children were educated. And in fact, Meg Cranston did her rug, which was on the wall of one of the classrooms, was a color chart, and it was their version of a kind of a color theory, you know, like you're taught in art schools here. And she made her rug from that color chart. So that was a very sort of, that meant a lot to her. Jen Guidi did watercolors of burkas, and I think her rug's up there somewhere. You may see it. There's rows of rather beautiful blue colors, and it's women. So my feeling about weaving is, it's, I think it's a big question as to how long hand weaving will last. I don't know the answer to that. I think Petra, you think probably, and Nepal will carry on for a long time, and I hope it does. But you know, it's a big question for everybody in this room. When you go into IKEA and you pick up a lamp for $5, do you ever ask yourselves, what did the person get who made that? Swedish. Yeah, he's Swedish. Sorry. Yeah.
Shout out to IKEA.
So I'll get that one in. And you know, it's a big question for all of us. Gap, you know, everyone knows the stories that people go to the factories in India or Vietnam or anywhere, and then they inspect them and it all looks very good, and then they move the stuff down the road when the people go away again. So it's, you know, we have to be realistic as to how much we can control, but we try our best. And we've done, you know, I don't want to get defensive, but we've done lots of things to help some of those weaving projects.
Joakim, you don't work as directly with the weavers. I imagine that's Kala.
No, I don't. I mean, what I do notice is that we select, yes, they're good weave certified, but then also depending, we sort of notice a sort of skill set between different weaving workshops. So we do allocate certain rugs to other weavers versus somebody else depending on the artwork at hand. So that's an interesting process in itself, that you sort of really realize that the weavers have artistic skill sets in their own right, that it's not just about 1 + 1 = 2. So that's an interesting process to determine as well.
Speaking of sort of stepping in, perhaps Christopher, you may be the most active, but I imagine that Petra and Joakim, now with your experience, you also can. Are there moments where you have stepped in a design process with an artist, between the artist and the weaver, and made suggestions to the artist based on the fact that the direction they want to, like, to give them a kind of material insight or more information that could make a better carpet? Like, how do you serve as a kind of catalyst or conduit to make the best of that version of carpet as possible, given that you understand more about weave options and you were talking about kind of the color matching and things like that? Like, how much of a role do you have to play in actually collaborating with the artists or even with the weavers to maximize the outcome?
Well, I have to say that this small workshop I'm working with, as more unusual the project is, as more excited they get. They really, and the gentleman who runs the show there, he says to me, Petra, we really don't just want to make a rock, we like to make those artworks. And that's really exciting. As to the artists, yes. You know, I explain beforehand to them very clearly, again, there's so many knots we can do, there's all the different materials, like, I mean, as I said, in the 80s, then, like, you know, it was wool, it was 80 knots, there was not much variation. Nowadays there's silk, there's banana silk, you can do hemp, you can do alu, which is like a nettle. I mean, there's so many different materials. They can carve 3D, high pile, low pile, there's so many more let's say, techniques that can be applied. So when I meet with the artists and I invite them, well, you know, Cornelia invited them, we presented them with all those different options and they picked, but interestingly enough, so far, with the exception of Rosemarie Trockel, does something a little different this time around. They still just, you know, picked wool and maybe a little bit of silk in between and picked the more traditional, what you know, like knotted carpet. Well, I mean, you have this more free form. My workshop could do that too. They have not picked up on that. But yes, but if I have the feeling they're coming with a design that's, there's one young artist who gave me a design and said, well, you know, in order to make this design, the carpet will have to be 10 by 20 meters because it's just so intricate. And then I tell him, you know, I go back to my workshop and he says, okay, this would have to be changed. I go back to the artist. And most of the times the artists are, so far, they like to collaborate because they want whatever they do, they want it to look good too. So that's not, has not been a problem.
Yeah, I think that's, I concur. I mean, when I look at a design, I mean, we have, as you said, there are many, many different routes to go down. But basically what I say to them is say, this is the weave that's going to work best to translate your design. And if they argue with me, I say, well it's going to look like shit. And I think that's very important. I mean, I'm not being facetious. You have to really assert your authority and say, you don't know what you're talking about. I do. And you can we can fight. And I don't mind some fighting and some heat. That's good. And then I'm always right. So you can push me as hard as you like. We can make a million samples, but I'm still going to be right at the end of it. In the same way I wouldn't teach you how to paint or do whatever you do in your practice. And so in a way, you have to sort of, I think that's, you have to have something to work with as an artist. I mean, an artist, a good artist, when they see a wall, will try and knock it down. In the sense, if they want to get somewhere and they have the sort of determination and the sort of drive to do it. And so I have to be that wall. So that's my job. And it's a lot of fun.
Most of the time,
it's a lot of fun. And if it isn't, I'm like Petra, and I say, yeah, you know what? Goodbye.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I'm like you like that. I've been in the situations where I've said, you know what, enough.
Yes, also, I mean, what's the point? You get a carpet produced, and I mean, for example, if I produce a carpet and it doesn't turn out well, or even the weavers make mistakes, I still pay them.
Sure.
You cannot go then. You cannot go and say, well, you know, I'm so very sorry. That's just like, that's not the orange I anticipated, and I'm not going to pay you. And I'm six people, you know, to live from that.
Yeah, I'm working on an app now, an anal retentive app, which will work perfectly, I think. And if you score very low, you're not going to make a rug with me.
No, but I think the skill that it's so integral is the manufacturer, the brands, the company, whoever outsources their production to the workshops, their ability to translate the artist's vision. That's what's key, and that's what made our rugs for Henzel Studio collaboration successful. It was Kalle Henzel's eye of how do we adapt these rugs into these works into rugs. Like the Marilyn Minter rug you see upstairs with the water drops, the cracks. That rug has 36 colors, it has 8 different pile heights. It was made with countless diagrams back and forth, and there's a whole digital layer before. It's not like, oh, I have this photograph, like I'm sending it to Nepal, and like, go weave. Like, there's a ton of communication and diagrams and renderings that are made to achieve that result. And with technology today, you can actually, close to 90%, achieve the result in a rendering that you then will see, okay, this is what the rug will look like. And if it doesn't look like that, a lot of times there's been just an accident in the color dyeing or miscommunication or something. But there is little accident, I think, to be left. But what's also interesting on top of that is, although this little accident within the creative process, that the outcome and each and every rug is unique, and they will always be different from one another. And that's something one has to embrace when it comes to carpets in general. Like, there will be no rug that is alike the other. And that's then something that one has to embrace. So although you want to control and have those correct facets, there's this sort of element of accident that's very alluring, mm-hmm. I think. And that's what makes it more of a piece of art.
So I think this is a perfect time to open up to the audience. Are there any questions among you?
Yes, Sarah. I was wondering if you could speak to if any of the weavers that you worked with were actually inspired artistically from working with the contemporary artists, whether there was any sort of actual personal interrelationship that happened, and not just from a political standpoint, but from a kind of artist to other kind of artist relationships.
Well, they're craftsmen. I don't think they think of themselves as artists. They're craftsmen. So, no, I think they're excited. You know, and I've done something, and they get very excited. They for this particular carpet of rosemary trockel, half of it looks like it's a flat weave, and it's a combination of flat weave and a knotted pile, but that actually doesn't exist. You can't do that like that. So they kind of developed a new technique. You know, they kind of fused some of the techniques they've used before and created that. And they were very excited. And when I was excited and the artist was excited, we're all excited together, and it's wonderful. But they see themselves as craftsmen. You know, they're not looking, they don't see themselves as artists.
I'm afraid, no. I wish I could say yes, but I haven't had that kind of dialogue. We haven't had that feedback.
Vicky?
I wondered, are these one-offs? Are they an addition, like a print? Are they ordered specifically to make them? How does it work in terms of the rug?
I think each company has their own rules, and I think
this is interesting because there are different rules among the team here. So you know, talk about your rules.
It's just sort of parameters that you set in terms of how you want to engage in that sector of the industry. But our rugs, they're numbered, but they're purposely an open edition because each, as I said before, each rug is unique. And let's say, like for a print, when you do a print of 50 prints, you pre-produce those prints, you have them in a pile, and then you sell them as you go along. With rugs, you don't pre-produce 50 rugs and have them in a room and sell them as you go along, unless the artist specifically was very sort of specific about size and things of that nature. But the way that it works to order one of our rugs is that it's a very high involvement purchase. So they can determine the size, and then depending on the size, then we adapt the artwork to first of all see if the artwork translates. We then run by them a rendering to see, make sure that the artwork is not compromised, and depending if they sign off, then we put it into production. But it's very well that, you know, we work with an artist and each rug with that artist is of a different size. But that said, they're numbered, they're certified, but they're not the limited edition to the point where the contract with the artist expires, and that information is confidential. So you go get them, and then, you know, if you don't get them now, then they might not be available. But I think you might have another.
We don't make many rugs, artist rugs. It could be six, edition of six. The Bourgeois was 12, two APs. It depends.
What about the Pardo and the Morris upstairs?
12, Sarah Morris. Pardo, I can't remember.
The Pardo, if you touch it, which you're not allowed to, it feels like a horse's nose. I just want to say it's 100% silk. It's the softest thing in the world. I hear. I didn't touch it. if somebody touched it, you would.
It's on layer wafer,
it's pretty much
so it's good.
Softest thing I've ever felt.
We're going to work on that, right? Yeah.
Yes, I mean, my carpets are editions of six. That's, I would say, the average edition size. I'm not that flexible with custom orders size-wise, because, I mean, for example, in the case of Rosemarie Rock Trockel, she puts a lot of thought in the proportion of the carpet, how it relates to the whole, you know, design of it and the look. So, I mean, to make this carpet then instead, I'm sorry, I've never adapted to feet, so I'm always in meters. For example, it's like 3.25 meters by 6.50 meters, and you would make it double the size, it would just look totally different, it had a different feel, so I'm not that flexible with it. But in general, I think the Rosemarie Trockel carpet is gonna be an edition of 12. It depends a little bit on, you know, it depends, I'm very flexible there, what the artist wants to do, or, you know, I mean, where I feel it makes sense, but small editions, and I have a certificate, and the artist will sign it. It's assigned by the artist edition.
Well, this is what's nice about doing something artistic outside of the art world, is that you can set your own rules. You don't have this established commercial structure that you have to abide by, so whatever works for your business model, and ultimately, we're running businesses, so you set your own guidelines.
I have a question about the craftsman. The craftsman. Can you hear me?
Yes.
The craftsman who makes this over and over again, will the craftsman evolve into the artist?
Evolve as the artist?
Yes. Can the craftsman actually become so good at
it's
what they
true,
do?
It's true, yes. I mean, we've noticed that rugs, I mean, if they repeat the work of an artist, that they get better, for sure. You can see that with a, let's say it's like a rug of something figurative, we can sort of see like human proportions. You notice that they get better at scaling, or the density of certain colors in certain areas are much more better off. Well, the more they learn how to do it. I mean, you can never get, the first shot is never your best.
Could you sell?
So you should buy like edition number 3, 4, or 5, or 6.
I mean, yes.
Can you sell? Eventually, would you be able to sell?
I'm sorry?
Will you be able to sell those craftsmen's
works? Sell the rugs that were made, the better ones?
Yes.
I mean, we don't differentiate between if it was like the first or the fourth made. But yeah, just they do get better.
Do we have additional questions?
All right, well, if you could join me in thanking our panel for a very rich discussion. And thank you all for coming. The exhibitions, both Wall to Wall as well as Andres Ruald, are on view until December 31st. So for any of your friends who have not seen them, please encourage them to come before the end of the month. Also, it is the holiday season, so it's worth me mentioning some wonderful opportunities for gift giving that relate to the exhibition. So two of them are the catalog, which I edited, so I know it's good, is available as a package with the purchase of a membership. So if you have someone that you think would connect with MoCA, a great gift idea is to buy them the catalog membership bundle so that they can take home some rich reading and beautiful imagery, as well as have the opportunity to come here for free for the next year. And then also very exciting, if you walk into our atrium and look above the elevator, you'll see four carpets by Maurizio Catalan. In addition to the carpets that were produced by our wonderful panel that are upstairs in the gallery, those four carpets are also available for sale, ranging in price from $1,200 to $1,400. Those are digitally printed on polyester, so they are not hand woven, and they do not represent the kind of production that we were talking about today, but the imagery and the quality is very high in the and very delightful. So if you are interested in that as well, our store associates can help you, and I can also answer questions. And then, of course, our store is filled with wonderful holiday gifts. So there's still about 15 minutes to see the show or to do some last-minute shopping. Have a wonderful holiday season if we don't see you again. If you'd like to come back next Wednesday, we have a fascinating talk between Andres Ruald and Daniel Patera. So I hope to see you back, and if not, have a great rest of 2016. Thanks so much.